I wanted to bring my environment, my oasis, my safe space to a place that I call a safe space, my second home. You know, I really want to thank Soho House for allowing me to bring me to the house. Because, you know, again, it's all about energy, right? Vibrations. I feel like you only attract what you're putting out, you know. And for a space like this to give me so much grace and show so much love, I can't do nothing but give them that love back. The couch storytelling, it started from me being on the couch and wanting to have these conversations inclusive of the culture.
And it's allowed for me to really carve a space in this world for myself. My guest has done the same thing. Making him feel just like myself. He's in the music industry. He knows this narrative so well, just like me. And we're going to talk about some stuff today. He's going to play some music. We got some tracks that we all going to listen to.
So without further ado, I want to bring up my first guest, Nathan Palmer, everybody. Just first, let everybody know who you is. You know, give us a brief backstory, and then we can get into it.
My name is Nathan Palmer, and I am a first foremost child of God, and I am a believer, and I'm an artist, I'm a producer, a former athlete, and coach as well now. So I just added that to the resume. So,
wait, where you from? Talk to.
I'm from Elkhart, Indiana. So I always tell people out of town, I'm from Elkhart, Indiana, by way of Chicago. I grew up in a small town in Indiana, and then I went to school, college, out at Northern Illinois University.
NIU.
NIU. And then when I spent a lot of time down here getting in trouble.
outside.
Look. That's pretty much it. I think Chicago is definitely the city that where I feel like I learned a lot more.
So again, you heard my narrative, and we got similar stories. So
yes, sir.
So talk to us about your journey to being an artist in the music industry today, coming from the playing field.
Man, you know, for me, it pretty much started as a child for me with music. I don't think I really took being an artist very serious until I left the NFL. And that journey was just, I mean, if anybody's ever been an artist or know any artist, like it's really a rocky journey. Sometimes you up, sometimes you down. I think the thing that I've been able to take from being on the field and being in an athlete realm and bring it over to the artistry is just understanding you got to weather that storm. And, you know, you can have a bad play, but always stay ready for the next play. Go to the next play. So I think just being able to do that has helped me navigate as an artist, you know, a lot more than probably, you know, the average artist. So.
And I think another thing, too, that helped us a lot to transition into where we're at today, because, again, I talked to him about this earlier, and people see the end product. They always see what you put out, right? Instagram is instant. You see what we post what we want you to see. So, like, how was that transition for you after playing? Like, give us a moment. Give me a moment, like, that was, like, that you remember that stamped you in your head, like, all right, this is where I know I'm going to be good after football. Like, this is where I'm supposed to be. Like, this is what God intended for me to be. Like, give me a moment.
Man, so, you know, they say it's really not a profession until you get paid for it.
Facts.
Right? So when I was doing football, I spent a little time on a practice squad here with the Bears. And I remember everybody would always be like, don't quit your day job, because my day job was playing football. So one week I felt I got a call from one of the members of the office, the front office from the Bears. And they asked, they go, hey, we're about to do this Christmas party. And instead of us paying, you know, for this big band, we heard you can sing. So if you really can sing, like, would you grab a band and we could pay you? And I was like, yeah, I could do it. I'm finna mess this party up. They don't know what's about to happen, right? So then I get in a party, and I'm like, all right, dope. But then the check that I got after that, not to say that I did it just for the check, but it let me know that I was going to be good after football, right? The check I got after for performing that week was actually more for being on the team and playing. And you know what those checks look like.
I know.
So that's when I looked and I said, well, hold up, what y'all trying to tell me?
Yeah, they aren't always always the best.
I mean, you telling me something because you just pay me more for music than
that was confirmation for you.
That was confirmation for me. And I think that is when I was like, all right, well, maybe I need to pay attention and actually go do it, because the people, my employer, just paid me more for something I love to do than the thing that I'm actually doing for them. And I felt like that was the moment.
Man, and I think, again, those moments of reassurance, I think it's just a universal thing. We all want reassurance, right? You know, whether it's from ourselves, whether it's from our partners, from our bosses, CEOs, whoever we're working for, we just want a little bit of reassurance. But I think the reassurance that we give ourselves is the number one reassurance that we need. And I think that's God's assurance, right? That's
Thanks.
Within. And so I'm glad you had that moment. Did you struggle with your identity after the game? And I'm asking this because I did. Because my whole entire career was wrapped up into sport. You know, coming from high school, number one player in the nation, all the media accolades. I didn't have NIL. I wish I had the NIL deal.
Boy, if we had NIL.
if I had the NIL deal when I was coming out, I would be like.
Look, napalm hot sauce would have been it.
Would have told me the money. No,
you feel me?
But talk a little bit about, I struggle with that identity because, again, NFL, NBA, that's such a big label, I mean, big name, right? Such a high prestigious thing to be a part of. And you've done it your whole life, and you think about when you walk into certain spaces. I remember living in L.A. because I went to USC. I was wild. Like, I was, you know, wilding. Like, before there was, like, even no L.A. Rams, we was the team, right? So I was just thinking about my ego was bigger than anything. And I say this humbly because I've always been humble, but we all have an ego in this room. Like, we got to just be 100 with ourselves.
Thanks.
We all have an ego. You just have to learn how to tame it. And, you know, once you remove ego, God comes in. But we still have ego. You have to walk with that. So talk about, you know, the struggle with identity after the game.
That's a great question. I definitely did struggle. I'll be transparent. Sometimes I still struggle, you know. Just being real about it, when you chase such a dream as such, I think I looked up the stats, it's like 23,000, 24,000 people have ever played professional football in the history of the game, right? So then when you factor that in, it's like the upper 1% of any athlete in the world has ever been able to accomplish that. So when you spend your whole life, like from a child, like, oh, I'm gonna get there, I'm gonna get there, I'm gonna get there, and then you get there, and then it's like, all right, what's next?
Right.
Even though I'm an artist, I sing, nobody in the room really wanted, I started to quickly figure out, no one in the room really wanted to hear the music,
wow.
Right? Because I was like, oh, well, I play football, blah, blah, blah. That was the conversation at first. So once the football was done and they threw former or alumni on that title, it was like, oh, okay, dope, dope, dope. Yeah, yeah, you doing music, bad, bad. Okay, cool, yeah, all right, cool. So then I started looking at myself like, well, dang, was I ever really
right
who I thought
I was? You second guessing yourself, like,
was I ever really who I thought I was?
Imposter syndrome creeping in.
And then conversation. I want to talk about certain things. You know, football get kind of old after a while, right? We talk about it all day.
Yep.
So then when I walk up to every conversation, it's like, yeah, you played for who? Dope. How was it playing with Peyton Manning?
Or right.
How was it playing with?
They be thirsty. They be, hey, you played with Hey, Drew Brees, huh? How was that in the locker room?
Like that? Who's better, Tom or Peyton?
I'm like, bro, I'm just blessed to be here. Y'all might cut me next week.
They did cut me next week.
They did cut me too. Niggas cut me too.
They did cut me next week.
They cut me too.
So, you know, you go through those things. And then also, I don't know if you went through this, but I also started to realize how much time I missed chasing that dream and missed a lot of moments with family, with friends.
Yeah.
Like, I had people that were getting proposed at certain events I would throw, and then I can't make the wedding because we're in football, we're in training, we're in a lot of things. And so when you come back to that world, I don't want to call it the regular world, but when you come back to that world with the family and friends, it's like, well, where do I fit in now?
Right.
Because they all have this life that has transpired over 10 years.
And we playing catch up a little bit.
And we playing catch up.
Yeah.
So I think that was another part of the struggle too as well.
Might be a loaded question. It's so funny, when I was a free agent in 2017, I went to the New England Patriots, and this is the time I was still sprinkling around, like, do I want to play in the league? Or do I want to, like, focus on my business, which is, you know, my film production business. I had a meeting with this scout. I had a great workout, and I had an interview. And I remember he was talking to me, and he was asking me these questions about, hey, Kyle, so what are you doing back home? Why are you waiting for the next opportunity? I got too heavily invested in the conversation of my film business. He was like, this nigga, do he think about football? And it's like, and this is a real conversation because, like, they want us to just be football, football, football.
Teach me the football.
I bench 225, go 30 down. You know, I run 4-3,
40. I'm running 4-3.
You know, I don't, you know, so, like, I got a degree from Northwestern. Like, I'm intelligent.
Let's clap on that. Let's clap
you know?
On that, first and foremost.
So, I appreciate that. And my mother always told me to go get that real paper first. And that's my degree. And I was, when I went to the league, I wanted to make sure I graduated. And so when I go to that conversation, I'm like, they just want you to be a dumb jock. They want you to just play football and then blow your money. They want to give you the bag. And then we still not even getting paid what we should get paid. You know, so we can get to that discussion later. But, like, it's so much that, like, when I got heavily invested in that conversation, I felt his energy change. So now look where we at. You know, so,
that
like,
part.
I want to know where that scout at, you know, today. But I just felt that energy and vibe. But back to my question, how much did music play a role in your life during your playing career, while you was playing?
I think music has always been a part of my life. And I think that was the biggest part of the struggle, honestly, too, being playing ball and keeping the right balance of having that in there. I think after, the first couple years of bouncing around, playing from team to team. So for anybody in the room, if you're not 1 through 22 on a roster, on an NFL roster, like, you literally could be here today and gone today. Not even tomorrow. Like, I
here
walked
today and going
gone
tomorrow.
Today. Right, like, for real. It was a couple times I walked in and roommate or teammate is walking in, we brushing our teeth, getting ready for camp practice, and I come back and his locker is empty.
Yep.
Or my locker is empty.
Talk about the Reaper.
Man, I don't know if y'all ever heard stories about the Reaper, but there's one person on every NFL team that's designated to tell you to bring your playbook.
Rough, bro.
And your notebook to the office. The GM would like to see you. So everybody identifies that person as soon as you walk in. It's like, oh, yeah, that's the trainer. That's the cook. That's the chef. Hey, bro, but that guy over there.
Stay away from him.
Stay away. That's the Reaper, bro. You see him coming, he coming to get you, right? So I think after going through that a few times, the only thing I really had to lean on in every city, because you start getting plucked at 22, 23, and now you're living in different cities by yourself. And it's like, do I want to get close to people? Because I could be gone tomorrow. I don't really want to make no new friends. And then now we,
right.
Where you go, Nate? Why you ain't show up or this? And so I think music became the heavy thing that I leaned on. I literally went and bought all my own equipment. I sat down, and I'm a self-taught engineer. Shout out to some of the best engineers in the building. I see Dave.
Shout out Dave.
A lot of times, like, you get cut, you get whatever. Instead of me expressing it on Twitter or...
Right, you put it in your music.
I just put it in the music, and then I will let that kind of calm my nerves and then be like, all right, I feel okay.
It's therapy for you.
Very much so.
Yeah. And
very
I think music
so.
Music is therapy for us. You know, music fuels emotion. Music, like look at this. Music brings us together, and it tells a story. So... Also, within all of that, how's your mental health? How are you currently right now today? Because I don't know if you all saw the drink menu, but we got three drinks. One of them is called Gentle Mental. Talk to me nice, because I'm talking to y'all nice. We just, you know, and the last one's called The Story. But I'm really going to be heavily focused on the mental health part of it. And that's why I asked you, like, how are you? Because... We do this, right? We don't check up on each other enough. I think we all need to do that. If somebody's within your circle, we need to really ask the question, like, how is your mental? Like, how are you? Because we're living in some times.
Yeah.
And I think that's a big question I want us to all ask each other. But how are you right now?
Man, I'll say this. I'm a lot better than I was before. Is my journey complete? No. But I like you said, we're living in times. So I feel my mental is good, but that's not a testament of just the work I've done. I think it's my supporting cast too, being understanding, being patient. You know, a lot of times we butt heads, bro, for a living. And
literally.
Even though I play receiver and we really, you know,
prima
those
donnas.
Dog prima donnas, we hit the ground a lot harder than a lot of people hit the ground. So
yes.
I don't know if y'all watch football now, But a lot of people pass out from even just hitting the ground, and I hit the ground way more in practice than the average person. So I think a lot of times those mood swings and stuff that you go through,
yep.
you really have to have understanding people around you to be like, you know what, bro, just having a moment, I'm still going to love on them. And I think once I felt comfortable with that, my mental started to clear up because now I'm not panicking or thinking about, man, am I not the person I was or like, you know, going through that ego death period. So now I feel a lot better. I feel great, skin looking great. I got, beer lined up. Shout out to Keith over there. Beer lined up. We good. We feeling good.
Yeah, that's
you,
love.
How you feeling, bro?
I'm glad you asked, man. I'm feeling great, man. I'm in such a place mentally where, you know, life is lifing right now. And I feel like the whole room understands that statement. Life is lifing. And you have to make sure you do check-ins. And that's hence why I asked that. But, you know, where I feel right now, I feel like I'm vibrating higher than the bullshit. And I think when I'm vibrating higher than that and anything, and I know that's a little vulgar, but the vibrations that I'm on outweighs anything that could step in my way, any opposition. God is really using me. That's the energy. That's my mental. It's like God is using me despite my career and everything. To be in a place where I can do this. Yeah. And this took a lot. And again, we need these conversations, and we need to have these mental health conversations more. So I'm in a great place right now.
Shout out to you, bro.
Thank you.
Shout out to the incense, too. Y'all smell the incense?
Yeah. Yeah,
we brought the vibes in.
Yeah,
like.
Man. I brought my house to the house.
For real.
And it's a good vibe for us. What's your thought? And now we're talking about, and we're going to get into some music. But I know we all witnessed this a couple weeks back, DeMar Hamlin on Monday night, and that was horrific for us all. Like, we've been conditioned to see the cart come out on the field. We've been conditioned to see the thumbs up as he's getting carted off. We've been conditioned to see the going to the tent. We've been conditioned to see, oh, he's out for 6 months, ACL, and all, that's cool. He'll be back. He's going to use that injury to come back better. That should not, none of the stuff that we have seen should be normalized. But what we saw from DeMar, we have never seen someone get it administered CPR. So if everybody saw the clips, you saw the players crying, right? Like in an emotional state, they're like, I even teared up. I went live in that moment on my Instagram because like, I never witnessed anything like that. And so what I said was that, I hope this is an opportunity for the NFL and just everybody in a culture of just sports and life and period, just to notice that what we go through as athletes is so much. And that right there, we witness somebody die on the field and get brought back to life, right? Thank God he's here, you know? But like, my question is, what are your thoughts on the DeMar Hamlin situation and did it play an effect on you? Has it had an effect on you?
Initially, I was scared like anybody else. I think whenever you go down on the field, if you've ever been hurt, I tore my MCL, PCL, partial to my ACL. And I just remember laying on the ground being like, dog, this could be it. This is that injury that your teachers and everybody talk about had that backup plan. So when I first saw it, you're right, I was conditioned to be like, ah, it's going to be an ACL. He'll be back. Like, he'll be cool. When I saw the CPR, I was like, nah, bro, they really trying to bring him back. And I think it scared me because it was like, all right, now I'm not even thinking of myself. I'm thinking of my nephew who, Uncle Nate, I just want to be like you. I want to play football. And I'm like, bro, I would much rather you not even do it. Right? Because in that moment, what people don't see behind the scenes, and I think this is what made this moment very big, is normally when something happens like that, they cut to commercial. Right?
Yep.
Y'all see commercials on TV. But what we see on the field is they pick somebody on the stretcher and they move everybody down the field.
Yep.
And it's just like, all right, we're going to get him out the way and then y'all continue going, right? And so there was a big tweet that came out from, I won't say who, you know, I don't like being messy like that. So there was a person, a well-known analyst who made a tweet like, well, keep the game going.
Yep. When they going to reschedule the game?
When they going to reschedule the game? And I was like, man, you know what's sad is we allow this. We allow them to be able to be like, he's just another gladiator.
Exactly. Just another body.
He's just another wounded body. So move him out the way and then keep the game going because we got money behind us. We got stuff going on. And I think in that moment, it made me be like, you know what? If I could find a way to advocate for people to just use their brain and do something that they really love and not have to play that system, I would much rather them do that.
Yep.
Because people are dying out there. They passing out. It's a lot going on in the world at the same time. You don't want some mother, some father.
That's somebody's child.
To lose their son. And they just looking at it like, all right, get him out the way.
Right.
I thought instantly about my nephew, but then I don't have children yet. But I literally was like, hey, if that was my son, I don't know what I'm going to do.
Yeah.
Because that's out of my control.
Yep.
That, you seen that hit, bro. That wasn't a bad hit.
So for those who didn't see it, it was a normal football play.
Football play.
But is football even normal?
It's not.
Like, now you're really looking at it like, is that even normal? We're grown men with equipment on clashing.
We both did it. The science behind it. You got the average person. I think I was 4'3", right? We're going to run 4'3".
That's
right?
Fast. I was slow as molasses.
It's okay, but you was a bigger body, bro.
I ran some good routes, great routes. Right. I made it look like I was running fast. But like I had to know the coverage scheme. I had to know who else was running their route. I said I had to do a little trickery to get open.
And I knew I wasn't getting the ball all the time. It was like, hey, bro, you fast? Clear everybody out.
Oh, you
out.
Running? We call them BTs.
Yes,
bus
bro.
Tickets.
Bus tickets.
Coach be like, if go run that BT. I'm like,
if you don't run it right, we are gonna order you a bus ticket. Okay.
You going home?
So that's literally all right.
Yeah,
but
bro.
Coming back to it. I'm running a 4.3 at the average on a human. That's about 18, 19 miles per hour on a football field. I'm weighing 190 pounds. You got a guy who's running just as fast as me weighing 250. Who's going to win that in physics? Who's going to win that in physics? Right? 250, you would think. But there's a coach in my ear like, no, you're a speeding bullet.
Right.
No.
Be having us out there.
You
wired.
Can literally run in there and you're going to mess him up. And I'm really believing it. Like, you're right, coach. I'm a speeding bullet. Boom. I want to be the cheesiest coach. And now I'm sitting there for the next 3 days like, bro, why does my head hurt so bad? I should have never ran in there. That was dumb. Why did I let him talk me into that? Mm-hmm. So just understanding that and seeing those plays is like, man, I know they're going to look at the play and literally be in the film room the next day because we've been there. And be like, this is just a normal play, guys. You still got to play 100%. You got to give it your all and just hope these injuries don't happen.
Yeah, and that's the thing, too, man. Like
what? Bro, he just died. Hope it don't happen? No, I'm good.
How many surgeries have you had?
One.
One?
And it was a light one.
I have 5.
Yeah, I'm cool.
Like, 5. And I know there's other athletes I know, friends that had more, but, like, these 5 are very, like, detrimental to my mental health, right?
Yeah, what?
Because I don't know, for those who are in the room, I had a film called Shifting Gears. It's one of my first documentaries that put me in a position to be where I'm at today when I talked about my opioid addiction. Damn. And from 2010 till 2014, I was heavily medicated all the time to play. I had to, you know, I wanted to play, right? And that's another thing, what you have to do to play. And I would get Toradol shots in my right butt cheek before every game. You know, and that just numbs takes away the pain. Or y'all get the cortisone, or they take a fluid out my knee because I had surgery on my left knee, right knee, left foot, right foot, my pinky. Y'all see my pinky? No tendons in here at all. Concussion was my most recent injury with the Saints. Lacerated kidney, he got weird fingers. Like it's a lot that we go through. Yeah, so that's a whole, like,
no tendons.
Art display right here. So it's a lot that we do with
my
this
germs. Make me precious.
What's that movie?
Scary movie.
What, scary movie.
My germs.
My germs.
Goddamn, I do look like that. what I talk about these stories, man, the opioid addiction, and I'm very okay with talking about it now because even when I talk about it today, it further removes me even more from it. And I think when we have problems and things that we deal with in our life, that's why we seek therapy. You know, I don't know who you all serve, but I serve an amazing God. And, you know, my God is the Most High. And without my family, you know, without them, I wouldn't be in this position to kind of, like, talk about this and be where I'm at. So these stories that we tell, man, are really because we need to help the next generation. And when I want y'all to leave this room tonight, it's like with something that's tangible, like, damn, I didn't know that about KP. I didn't know that about Nate. I didn't know that they had to go through all that to be where they are today. I just saw them, you know, I just see what I see. And so I want to get into some music. I got three songs from you. I was just at your performance yesterday at the Soothe Your Soul. We was lit, turned up. It was a good time. Shout out to Dana, was in the lit. This first song is called Shyami. And yeah. Talk to me a little bit about Shyami before we play it, and then we're going to talk about it at the end.
Okay. Shyami was a unique one. I think I made it 2 years ago. It came out last year. But when we created it, we had a lot of friends come in from all out of town. I think a few were from New York, a few people from D.C., and a couple people from Miami. Mm-hmm. And one thing everybody was shocked about is going on Lakeshore Drive or going out there on the lake, and they're like, yo, it looks just like an ocean. Like, I feel like I'm in Miami, but it's not, right? So it started as a joke where I was like, it's Shyami. One person said it in the group, and it was like, hey, it's the perfect blend between Chicago and Miami for the summertime. Everybody in here can probably agree, summertime shy, there's nothing like it in the world, right? So I was like, hey, the music frequencies, starting to understand that we have a lot of rap music that kind of glorifies the Chirac mentality.
Yep.
And I don't ever want to go away from it because that was a part of history. If you know, you know, right?
If you know, you know.
But I said, I can be a part of the problem or I could be a part of the solution. Mm-hmm. So when I made a song, I said I wanted to make an R&B song. Ladies love R&B.
Yep.
That's a chill vibe. And to give them another name for the city outside of Chirac. So when I played Shyami, I wanted to give everyone that heard it a sense of ownership, to be like, this is what it looks like. It feels very bossy, braggadocious a little bit, but
yep.
The main key behind it was I wanted everyone to be able to call this part of Chicago something different. You got Chicago, you got Chi-Town for the outside, you know, world, and then you got Chirac, but I wanted to now incorporate Shyami.
Nice.
And what's weird is I was like, maybe only four or five friends will start calling it that, but it literally started to spread. You see sprinkles of it here and there.
Yep.
And I said, if I could just be that first seed that planted it and now gets people an option to whether say, yo, I'm from Chirac.
Right.
Nah, I'm from Shyami. Or you ever been to Shyami? You ever been on a lake? You ever had the boats? You ever been downtown? You ever been River North versus you ever been in the trenches? You ever been in the hood? You ever been on 87?
You ever been on
Cotton? Right. Playpen.
Yeah.
So that was the vibe behind it. Shout out to Nelson Hercules. I think he works here at Soho.
Oh yeah, Nelson. Yeah, shout out to
Nelson.
TTPMG.
So I was recording that song and he had a friend that came in, and I'm not gonna lie, as an athlete, you know, when it's your world, you get kind of bullyish a little bit. So in the studio, he was like, hey bro, I got a guy coming in and he's been going through it today. Do you mind if he just comes in and write a verse or just be in the studio with you while you work? I say, yeah, yeah, cool. So I hear him humming in the background while I'm recording. And normally all my homies know, like, you hum or whatever, I'll probably turn around and be like, hey, bro, let me do my thing real quick, right?
Right.
So I heard it and I looked over. I said, hey, bro, you should lay that down. Never knew that he was really, his whole testament, he freestyled it, but that's what he was actually living. And he came up to me after and was like, hey, bro, you made me want to stay in Chicago. I was about to leave.
Wow.
Just because the city was doing that much to me. So I was like, all right, this is our authentic story now.
Yeah.
And so now you have this young black man and this young Hispanic Latino guy collabing together on a record. And never knew it was going to be what it was. Ends up on the radio one night. Friends start calling me. Oh, man, you got a song on the radio. I'm like, what song? Southside? What? And then they play that one. And I was like, wow, that's crazy. So now it's working. So I feel like that was a testimony for when your intentions are pure, it's all going to find its way and it's all going to work out. So.
And with that, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to get to that right now. We're going to play Shyami for y'all. Let's get to it.
Dope.
Yeah. hit me when you touch down in my city. Send your location, I'll be on my way to you.
I'm back with some exotic and some Henny. Baby, tell me if you really coming through. Cause she wanna dance and shame me. She call her girls, they call their friends, they making plans to shame me. Ooh, you like to dance and shame me. You call your girls, they call their friends, we making plans to shame me. We gon' hit the city, you could name your price. I get Big Frank like Nitty, my wristwatch dipped in ice. I brought my family with me, and it's one hell of a night. I'm the man of my city, so please talk to me nice. 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 I get Big Frank like Nitty, my wristwatch dipped in ice. I brought my family with me, please talk to me nice. Yeah. So yeah, that's my verse. And this is my homie Manny.
Hey,
the faces, back to the problems. Sleeping them closing my eyes. I felt this verse though, bro. He was so real.
I like it, man. And the thing about it.
Close to a lie. Look to the left and the right. We ain't no similar guy.
Keep going.
Basement trying to think
keep
how
going.
To provide.
Keep
I had
going.
To categorize. I had to prioritize. All of my goals in the one. I had to put down the gun. Needed the shooter, I loaded the pump. Need a commuter, I rode on the bus. A shining reflection. I almost know his verse, and I only like, dang. Let's go. Cause I've been on the edge of this lifestyle. Like an addict, not putting a pipe down. She around, I'm putting a pipe down. Needing the lights out. Remember when? I remember when. I remember when. We gon' hit the city.
Get that drink.
You
talk
can
to me
name
nice.
Your price. I get Big Frank like Nitty. My wristwatch dipped in ice. I brought my family with me. It's one hell of a night. I'm the man of my city. So please talk to me nice. 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 I get Big Frank like Nitty. My wristwatch dipped in ice. I brought my family with me, yeah. Please talk to me nice, yeah.
Hey.
Appreciate y'all. Thank y'all.
Man. Listen. Listen, bro. He performed this. It's the energy is crazy, man. So now that we all heard Shyami, give it up one more time for Shyami. I feel that. I feel that energy because, like you said, Chicago in the summertime is Miami.
What?
Like, and everybody, it definitely is Miami. So when you made that song, now we talking about the lyrics, right? Now we talking about the words.
Right.
Talk to me nice, right?
Yeah.
You know, we got the drink that you guys can get.
Yes, sir, sir.
But again, we talk to me nice. Talk a little bit about that line, the talk to me nice line. I
feel
think
like
that's a real nice line.
I just feel like that's Chicago. Like, that's Chicago's energy. Anywhere you go, when you meet somebody from Chicago, it's like, you can play with us if you want to, but you better talk to me nice, right? Even the women, like, the women, the men, everybody, front to back. It's like, hey, you guys, boy, I'm from, they'll be quick to tell you, I'm from 79th or something, or I'm from 63rd, boy. Yo,
facts.
I'm from over
facts.
East, boy. You better talk facts. To me nice. So I felt like that was the energy where
facts.
Me sing. My friends used to always joke, a person can rap something and one person can sing the same thing and it's always going to be received well or a little bit better if you sing it, put
yep.
a melody behind
mm-hmm.
it. So I felt like I can give you that energy but soften it up a little bit by just like being cool with it. Talk to me nice. So
yeah,
please talk to me nice. I brought my family with me. You feel me? I got my family, so you better talk nice because – Uncle, cousin, all them back here, I might be cool, but they might mess it. No.
Yeah, they no, and that's the thing. You
shut
know,
the club
family
down.
Family got
bro.
Your back, man. You know,
yeah.
you got to always roll with some real ones around you, man. Shout out to the real ones in the room. Shout out to my family that's here and that my peoples that helped put this together. You know, Boye, Rihanna,
Yo.
Alexis, Alex, who else? Portia, Mel, Kaylin, you know, just I could keep going on and on, my production crew. We got to make sure we shout out the people that put us in position, right? I always want to make sure we always let people know it's in this life that we live and the, where we're going and want to go, we got to have a solid core. You need a solid group of people that got your back. And I roll with some real ones, man. I like to think that, you know, you one of the people on my crew too, man. So
definitely.
Let's keep that energy going.
Definitely.
What was one project that you did that let you know that music thing, that this music thing might be for you? Like,
It definitely was Lakeshore Drive.
Lakeshore Drive?
Yeah, definitely Lakeshore Drive. To be transparent, one of the songs that ended up being on the radio from Lakeshore Drive, I made 4 years prior to me ever playing it for anybody in the regular world. That one too. Yep. So I think it was my most getting out of my own way project where I didn't think. I just went in, I made music that felt good. I didn't try to make it specific for like, oh, this gonna go crazy on Blase Blar, this is gonna go crazy in the club. It was just like, I'm making what I feel and what I want to put out in the world frequency wise. And for it to be only 18 minutes, I think it was my most streamed project, but also well known music people that I respect
in the industry.
In the industry, literally started coming up, and when they would meet me or see me out, it was like, yo, bro, I listen to Take It Back or Shyami or Division Street is my song. And I'm like, dang,
that's
bro.
That's one of my favorite. We're going to get to Division Street and Southside, but Division, really, y'all going to love Division Street. So I really like that. That's my joint right there, for real, for real. But
so I think once I started seeing that, it was like, yo, I really wasn't expecting this. So the fact that it's being received this way, it started to let me know, like, all right, bro, you might actually be who you think you are in your head. And have been doubting for so long. Yeah. It's like, now it's just going to be him.
That doubt is, so talk about it. Talk about that doubt, right? We call that imposter syndrome.
Yeah.
And I know a lot of people in this room, we're creators, we're all artists. I just think we have moments where we doubt ourselves, right? And this is where the confidence has to come in, the experience has to come in, and the war wounds have to come in. So talk about those moments of doubt that you've had.
Man. I think as an artist, it's way more than an athlete, because a lot more is out of your control. Like, when you're an athlete, you're like, I know my body, I know what I'm going to do, I know what I'm really good at doing, so I'm going to do that. But then in music, it's like, I can feel like it's the greatest thing I've ever done and play it in this room, and everybody look at me like,
Right.
And then I can take something that was the worst thing I've ever done. I think we were all in the studio last night after the show, right? And I'm just playing music in the background, and one of my old songs that I did like 2 years ago comes up where I'm like, bro, that is trash.
Right.
Went crazy. All the homies went crazy. Bro, you ain't put this out? What is this?
But in your mind, you like, that's trash. And if somebody else here, they
trash.
Like, wow.
I don't even know why I made that. What was I thinking, bro? Why was I in there singing this? Y'all really let me sing this. The engineer need to be fired. Manager need to be fired. Everybody need to be fired because y'all really let me do this. And then I play it, and they're like, bro, this is amazing, bro. This is, bro, I will play this. I will bump this even if I didn't know you.
Yeah.
So I think that imposter syndrome comes in. And then also just, like, coming from the athlete world, I'm sure you dealt with this. When you say you do film, but you play in the NFL, they're like, okay, but do you really do film?
Right.
Or are you just an NFL player that now you can do film? So in music, a lot of times they're like, oh, yeah, he played in the NFL. He low-key can sing. Low-key. Yeah, he got a little album out. Little album.
Yeah, I don't
what
like
you the, mean?
Eliminate the word little.
Little. Like, boy, I'm 6 foot 205.
You're not little about me, man.
You better talk to me nice, right? Like,
better grab you a drink from Soho House tonight at 7 to 9 p.m.
You
talk to me nice.
You feel me? Like, so I think having that those moments, but also pushing through them, and now having, like you said, the support system and family, where now it's like, all right, even when I do feel that, go back to what you know, just like an athlete, to regain that confidence and just be like, I'm him. It's not to say I'm him more than anyone else in the room. We all him, her, they. I know we got
you're
a lot
him,
of
you're him
we got a lot
you.
Of codes to say.
You're
now,
him
but
for you.
I'm him.
for you.
And I have him within me, yep. If you understand. If that go over anybody here, we'll talk about it later. But yep. I have him within me, so I have to be him. Mm. And I think now I'm just now starting to get there. Like, I just said it. Mm. To the homies, like, y'all really feel like, I really feel like I'm arriving. I'm here.
Yeah.
You know, so.
You are, bro. And, again, that's why when I called you, what better way to start, you know, my first episode and series with somebody who I know has been on the same journey as me, and we gonna get there together. And, again, these conversations is for us to all be together. It's all-inclusive conversations. So my next question is, what was one of your highlights from your playing career? And how does that success or that highlight compare to your success today in music?
Oh, I think it came from practice, if I can say that.
I'll go for sure.
Okay, camp, rookie year, I get out to San Francisco. I have this story time, y'all. I like to tell stories.
That's why we're here.
With me, right? You have Randy Moss, Michael Crabtree, Mario Manningham.
Wow.
Ted Ginn Jr.,
sheesh.
Kyle Williams, A.J. Jenkins, who was a first-round draft pick in my rookie class, and you have Brett Swain, who played with the Packers and won a Super Bowl. So that's seven guys. Now my agent was looking at me like, bro, why did you want to go there, bro? That's like seven pro ballers.
Right.
So they put us up against an all-pro corner, Carlos Rogers.
Mm.
Toast him for a post.
Nice.
I'm thinking it's an accident.
Was it press covers or was it
press covers? 80 months.
You went inside. You went inside.
Boom, boom. Went inside. Dipped the shoulder. Gave him a little set at the top. You feel me?
Sorry, y'all. It's football. It's still in this. I'm sorry.
It's still in it.
I'm sorry, y'all. I'm up here getting excited. I'm like, did you get inside? Did you get inside release? Did you stem him upfield? Did you get eight?
Because like, what you don't know is you go outside on the post. That's called a bus ticket.
Mm-hmm.
They're gonna get you a bus ticket home. So that's, y'all see how much is engraved in? It's like, nah, bro, you run a post, dip that shoulder, get yep. inside. And people be
PTSD.
And they it, right. They make it hard for you, too. It's like, bro, how am I going to get inside? And he's sitting where bro sitting right here. Like, I can't go over there. I got to go all the way to the camera, bro. Like, what you want me to do? So so I beat Carlos. And, you know, wide receivers growing up, when you catch a ball over somebody, everybody yells, Moss. So I walk back to the huddle. And Randy Moss goes, all right, young thing, you the Mosty, right?
I know that.
So now I'm like, oh, man, Randy Moss said I'm Moss somebody. Oh,
that's hard.
It's up.
That's hard,
it's
bro.
It's up. Next play, I come out, right? I run the same post. Kaepernick throws me a dart, hits me dead in my chest, bounces off my chest. Now Randy come over, boy, sound like you got shot in your chest, boy. That's crazy, boy. You better get them hands. You shouldn't have had that popcorn. Your hands a little slippery, right? So now I'm like, dang, I'm crushed just that fast. So then he looks. They have a receiver in. He looks, and he comes out the huddle, and he goes to Harbaugh. Put Nate in. I said, huh? Bro, I just dropped this whole post, bro, and y'all talking trash about me.
Yeah.
Put Nate in. I come back in. He said, hey. You're going to make up for that. The ball about to come to you because of the coverage. I already know what it is. You're going to line up. I'm going to set it off. Once you catch it, you're going to bump out, and you got the ball. Show them what you got. I believe in you, kid.
That's some Lifetime movie shit just now. Come on. Like, you can't write a better script for, like, something other than what you just experienced.
Until I dropped it, but it was okay. It was okay. It was the thought that counts.
Right.
Like, he had
right.
that much faith
right.
in me, bro. Like,
yes.
To be like, hey, put Nate in. He going against the head coach, right? So that, in that moment, taught me that the icons that I look up to,
yeah,
the people that I wore his jersey in middle school,
mm-hmm.
literally saw something in me before I saw it.
Yeah.
And was like, hey, I'm willing to stick my neck out as that guy in the room and be like, this next play, he need to come to redeem himself. So, coach, I know you are all pro coach. You got whatever on your resume, but, like, I'm one of the greatest of all time to do this. This little kid needs this opportunity. Come in here. That said everything to me.
And I think, bro, that's – we talked about affirmations earlier. Like, that's reassurance from a GOAT. You know what I'm saying? Whether you – I know you dropped the ball, okay. But, like,
I dropped it with the most proud face ever, bro. It was like, look, I'm.
But this story is forever going to live. But this story is forever gonna live, and it's so inspiring, bro, because what you did is, again, it's a story that you could tell to us, and it's like inspiring for the next generation. You know, not too many people can say Randy Moss said to me, I mossed somebody.
You feel me?
You know what I'm saying? Like, that's hard, bro.
And
like,
now it's a whole segment on Sundays, like, Moss, you got mossed. And I'm like, bro, I lived that.
Yes. So, no, that's an amazing moment, bro. And Randy Moss is definitely one of the cultural, like, he's very one of the, like, cultural icons, too. I would say one of the tastemakers, too, from, like, just him being himself. And I see a lot of athletes, Primetime, Randy, the guys that be themselves, like Chad Ochocinco's of the world.
Yeah.
Those guys I really looked up to because they were allowed to be themselves. Now, when you're undrafted and you're not as highly talented, you're not an A-list player, you can't be yourself all the time.
No.
Now, that's where I struggled at a lot, right? Because I knew my spirit. I'm a peacock. I want to do all these things. I've been a curious kid my whole life. And I'm like, but my resume, football-wise, said 5 surgeries, undrafted. I have to stay late after practice. I got to be on special teams. I got to walk around the locker room with my tail tucked underneath because, like, coaches got me on a short leash because I know they might be about to cut me soon. I got to do everything right.
So, like, Reaper in the corner.
The Reaper right there in the corner. And
just staring at you while you eat your food.
Staring. You know, I got cut after having, like, one of my best games in preseason. So I had a press conference and everything. I'm up there talking on the podium, like, yeah, they're like, where you from? Like, you know, Northwestern, went to USC, and then I was all excited about your first catch. I almost went for a touchdown, talking to the reporters, and then I'm in the locker room, then the Reaper walking, and I'm just, like, deflated. I'm like, damn, bro, I just did a press conference. How y'all cutting me?
Like, bro, I'm balling right now.
I'm balling.
So
it's tough, bro.
You got to tell them about how sometimes, and this is one thing I had to learn, too. So any football players watching this or whatever growing up, sometimes it's out of your control that you get cut at such a high level.
Right, it is.
And that's what I didn't understand. Like, I'm balling in camp, doing everything right.
Numbers.
A defensive end goes down with a sprained ankle, and they need that roster spot, so they got to bring in another defensive end.
Yep.
And, Nate, you number 5. Even though you balling, we love you. Like, you can sing, bro. We like it when you sing. We love it.
Line.
It's great.
Line.
Like, great. Yeah. But what we have to do is we need that roster spot. So we're going to demote you today. We're going to put you on practice squad, bring your playbook, bring everything in, and if you clear waivers, we'll bring you back, okay? Yeah. But for now, yeah, we'll need that, and just good luck, buddy.
Yeah, they look good luck, buddy.
Good luck, buddy, right?
Like, that's the most diminishing thing.
And you're like, bro, how I'm balling and y'all still cut me? That's like saying, like, oh, I love you, but it's not you. Like, you don't want to hear that when you break up. Like, no, bro. Oh, I love you. Trust me, it's not you, it's me, like.
Right, on some Seinfeld shit, playing with our emotions and stuff.
Right. So, yeah.
Man, that's crazy. Well, so let's talk about, let's shift gears a little bit. No pun intended. Shout out to Shifting Gears. If y'all haven't seen that, it's on ChasingGreatnessProductions.com. Shifting Gears is about transitioning. But let's talk a little bit about the culture today in terms of the music industry. And we're going to play Southside. Right now, one of your tracks.
Yeah.
But, like, let's talk about the culture today in terms of the music industry. Talk a little bit about it before we get into the song.
We going to pray for the culture of music. I don't want to say too much because, you know, they like to get people like me and they take us in the back room and beat us up for talking too much. But,
you know, give us talk. I mean,
I pray for the culture of music because it has a stronghold on our youth.
Talk about it.
And I even had to learn with my pen, with my voice, and to be a little bit more careful with what I'm putting out there because these kids are 9 times out of 10 raised just like we are. We were, our parents were, our grandparents were, even cavemen when they started discovering music, right? But we're all raised by our favorite music, our favorite musicians. And I think now, it's not even about the music anymore. It's about what we can see online and how do you look and who you're dating and what are you spending your money on and how much money you have and all this stuff, right? Yep. So the frequency of music is lost. Yep. All we listening to is lower frequency music.
Yep.
And it's starting to change our world.
It is.
And I think a lot of the angels of music, are now being brushed to the side or not heard of as much because it's so much oversaturation.
Yep.
But the reason I say I pray for the culture of music is because I still think music has healing in it.
Yep.
I think the people we have to heal first, and then the music will start to change. Perfect example, NBA Youngboy, right? I think I saw an interview recently where he was like, yo, I'm responsible for a lot of these deaths. They listening to my music when they go do it.
Right.
So I have to make better music because I'm responsible for these people. Mm-hmm. He's only 20-something.
Yeah.
So if we get more guys to be like that in the music, and I'm only speaking on the music I listen to, right? Not all music is like this. But if we get more people in our culture,
because
our culture really does drive the world. I don't care what nobody say.
We do.
And it started in Chicago, low-key. So, I mean, shout out Chicago.
No, we do. We do drive music. I think we need to pray for the culture in terms of music and our youth, the next generation. We do have power in our words. And, you know, rest our soul, rest in peace. Nina Simone, she says this. She say, as a storyteller, as an artist, we must reflect the times in which we live in.
Yes.
And me being on this stage, you being on this stage, we have the power to invoke culture and move. And, you know, that's why I love filmmaking so much, because I love to evoke emotion. I love to pull that heartstring. I love to take you on this roller coaster of a ride. But again, it's like we have to make sure what we're saying and these words and these lyrics, that they are conducive, that we can actually push us forward. So I'm glad you're conscious of your pen, right? You know, another thing too, I'm an artist as well. And when I be freestyling, I notice that, like, when I'm freestyling and it's not of God and I start speaking about secular stuff, I start messing up. Like, God be like, bro, that ain't you. Hey. You don't sell dime bags now. I'm not pushing no work, you know. But again, it's like we got to be very conscious of our words, man, and the stories that we tell, because our youth are dying here in Chicago. It's crazy the numbers and the statistics when I look at them, as to like our communities and how we're like the music is putting us against each other. It's talking about us not it's us about being better than the next generation and, you know, keeping up with the Joneses and flexing on my brother, you know, flexing on my sister, you know, trying to see how much she got. We pocket watching, you know, trying to do all these things. Again, I can't stress this enough. We must vocalize these things a little bit more and be conscious of like an NBA young boy saying like, yo, I'm responsible for these deaths. You know, a lot of these artists that we glorify are responsible for the deaths that happen in our communities. And the industry, you know, again, they notice. The industry knows the music that they're pushing and how it's heavily influencing us and what they're doing.
Listen.
And so, again, that's just something I want us to be conscious of, and which is going to lead us into our next song, Southside, right here from Nate.
Yes, sir.
And now we're going to get into it.
Yes, sir, Skate.
This you, bro. This on the south side. Lace up popping, it's a big vibe. Got some papers and gelato for the long ride. Let the top down, baby, get some moonlight. Moonlight. Yeah. On the
south side. Lace up popping, it's a big vibe. Papers and gelato for the long ride. Let the top down, baby, get some moonlight. Moonlight. Yeah. She like to cruise around with the stars. In expensive fast cars, I know. Little baby, she be dripping just like water. I'm about to change her life here tonight for sure. Cause I know that she been waiting for a real one to touch on her body. I'm thinking that I might be the right one to love on her body. Ooh, ooh baby, they don't make them like you no more. Yeah. She call my bluff and tell, she tell me pull up on his outside. Lace up popping, it's a big vibe. Got some papers and gelato for the long ride. Let the top down, baby, get some. Yeah, yeah. On the south side. Lace up popping, it's a big vibe. Papers and gelato for the long ride. Hey, yeah, yeah. manicure dripping down her front door. The red bottoms on her pedicure toes. Henny in the nail, got the shawty in the zone. Little baby cop the dame for the low. City girl, take a ride with me. Blow some 87 in the sky with me. Anything you want when you slide. I mean anything you want, slide with me. Ooh, baby, yeah, yeah. Ooh, baby, they don't make them like you no more. Oh, she called my bluff and told me, baby, pull up on the south side. Snap. Hey, hey, there we go. Yeah.
I know she was feeling it.
Yeah.
Shout out to Dana in the crowd.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's a big vibe, baby. For the low ride lady. Yeah, yeah. Meet me on the south side. Late night. Your daddy just don't know. Meet me on the south side. Big vibes. I bought some trees to blow.
I saw a couple Lloyd fans back there. Is that what it was? Yeah, yeah.
That was Southside. Y'all give it up for Southside, man. Man, Southside, man. Man, Southside. Shout out to people from the Southside. Anybody from the Southside in here?
Yeah.
Hey, shout out to Southside. Shout out to Southside. Talk to us about Southside, man. I like that song a lot. Talk to me about it.
Man, shout out my boy Cali. He produced it. His name's Cali.
Okay.
They call him Cali Got the Juice. So whenever you hear that on any song of mine, that's my longest collaborator. One of those friends that I relied on a lot when I got out of the league. But he played that song while we were setting up music equipment in a studio, right? And we were doing another session. And I think at the end of the session, we had like 30 minutes left. And so I was like, hey, bro, pull up that beat you played in the house the other day. And 23 minutes, I think it was, we looked at the time, because I was like, dog, we just made this whole song that fast. So 23 minutes later, that's what you got. And literally that song was not touched. It's fresh, whatever you got out the studio, that was it. I didn't think it was gonna be anything. I wrote it to sell it.
Yeah.
And thinking it was just gonna be a quick little vibe. And my business partner, Rita, shout out to her.
Shout out to Rita Lee.
She heard it, was like, nah, give me that. I know what to do with that. She said, the city of Chicago needs a song like this. And I was like, all right, cool. Next thing I know, I wake up, it's number 4 on the radio.
Nice.
On WGCI. Shout out Jamal Smalls because he played it everywhere and he was the first person to hear it and support it. And that song literally changed my life. Like, I was out here still trying to figure out, you know, who I was, what I wanted to do. And that song kind of put me on the map. I think a lot of people respected me as an artist
because
they would hear it, not know it was me. And then it would pop up my name, and now it's just
a
vibe.
You got a distinctive voice, man. You got a great voice. And
it's very raspy. Sometimes I don't like it.
It's not Life Jennings raspy. You know, Life Jennings sound like he had 6 Popeyes biscuits. You know what I'm saying? It's like,
with
you don't
no
sound
water,
like that,
bro.
You know,
water. Help me.
You know, but nah, you're good. You're good. Your voice is good.
I appreciate it.
Man, I think, like you said, you was in that period of trying to figure out your sound, and I think that's where I'm at too. Like, I'm in that phase where I'm like trying to figure out my sound, and I think I found that my sound is just like, it can be anywhere, you know. It's
you
up and down.
You got a soulful sound, bro.
I test that to my family, my father. I grew up on music. Music is something that, like, from the moment I was born, you know, my dad had vinyls, you know, playing like oldies, Smokey Robinson, the Otis Redding, you know, James Brown, Aretha Franklin. You know, I'm talking about old records and these, like, in the whole record. So when it got to, like, you know, me making music and, like, sampling, and, like, I can give y'all a little taste right now. As to what the soul is talking about. This is my MPK, and I just be vibing, like, you know, just a little something like this, you know. Okay. I'm chilling with my homies. Most of my homies, we ain't never been phony. Back in the gym, I used to be scrawny. Nah, I put on a little weight, nah, nigga ain't bony. Nah, but these are stories that we tell. I pray to God that I stay well. Shout out to Ye, shout out to Ho. When he made that song called Jail, I was like, damn, that's a story I would like to tell. But I'm a freestyle killer. Yeah. I'm off the dome, I'm a mental, so I keep it real skriller. I believe in people when they don't believe in me. And that's the thing I had to see, I had to conceive in me. I make the beats when I make it, I'm off the dome. I sit at home, God, I pray into the throne.
Yeah.
Please, please leave me alone. I got a gentle mental. That's why I brought my crib to this home.
Whoa.
Shut out the Soho House, man. I try to move smooth. I like to be like a mouse, so I...
Quiet.
I'm deep up in the drought. I'm just praying to the God that I might go and see the South, so...
Daddy.
South side, shout out to the West side. I got to talk to all sides, because all sides is the best sides.
Whoa.
Man, everything that I went through, I pray to God that I can do the Kamehameha, so call me Goku.
Whoa.
I'm on your favorite TV, Roku, but I'm going to tell you something. My bikes I had on some spokes, too.
Whoa.
But that's a little ball. Something for the soul. I'm a soulful brother. I be writing down my goals.
Whoa.
Writing down my goals. She beautiful. Beyonce knows. But when I put my finger on my nose, I say nose goes. But that's just a little flow for my people. I want y'all to know I'm making art just like I'm people. 69 mil for the thrill. I was trying to be freestyling. Now I'm writing contracts and deals.
Whoa.
Make a milli, man. Shout out to Philly. I know they didn't win the Super Bowl, but them niggas still making about a milli.
That part.
They still making about a milli.
That part.
Nah, but that's just something, though.
Yeah. These are just stories.
You know, these are the stories, man, you know. But yeah, like, music is something that's like...
Bro, that was hard, bro. Can we give it up for him again?
No, I appreciate it. Appreciate it. Music, again, like for me, it's therapy, right? And when I wanted to create this space for us to like be in, I prayed over this room. You know, I pray over my tongue, my words, and I pray over us. You know, I prayed over like this conversation because, like I said earlier, if I'm get to talking, if I can't rap, and then I get up here and rap secular stuff, and it's gonna just mess up. You know, because that ain't God. God's like, that's not you. That ain't what you do, you know? Mm-hmm. And I'm like, I rap from experiences. You know, I create from experiences. And this couch, I went through so much on my couch in these past couple of years, 2020, the pandemic. We all in this room went through something. I kid you not, whether you was with someone or with your family or with a significant or you spent time alone, you had to deal with something in your life, right? You had to look yourself in the mirror and figure out, like, who... are you? What do I need to deal with? God set us down. And that was a time for us all to be isolated for a reason. So I used that time to really dive into myself, dive into my artistry, dive into who I am, dive into everything that I know God is shaping and molding me to be. And that's a storyteller, and that's creating music. So that ear, you know, I lived in L.A. Shout out to Cosign and Two. The interns.
Yes, sir.
My brothers, you know, I was able to be in the studio, be around artists like Bruno Mars, Big Sean. You know, I met Kanye, and I'm seeing all these people, like, and I'm just in the back. Like, I had a video on my Instagram talk about being in the room, right? Being in the room is just sometimes being present, like, and not saying a word. And I'm seeing these legends, and I've soaked up all this information, all the, how they, you know, Yo. I saw them do that, and like I just watched it. And I'm like, I hear certain things that people don't hear. I feel certain things that people don't feel. And so once I started doing it myself and started to like getting confident and started writing, you know, doing it. I'm more so freestyle than I am writing. If I do freestyle something like that, I'm like, I gotta record it and I go back and write to it.
I so tell them voice memo all the time in my studio,
Dave. Something they used to tell me, be like, bro, why you ain't got your voice memo on? You know, because we'd be in the studio and we had sessions, and he's just like, bro, make sure you got a voice memo on, always record. And but yeah, music is what keeps me going. Music is therapy, bro. And as you know, that's what, you know, is what fuels emotions. So,
yes, sir.
Which gets us back to, I'm gonna play some the vibes back on again for us. What type of stories do you like to tell? Like, what's, as you saw my pocket, right? You saw me freestyle. Like, what's your pocket? Like, what's your tempo? Like, where you at?
I like love stories.
Love?
Love stories, most of the time, for me. I think I'm low-key, like, I think the term is hopeless romantic, but I don't know if that's the right term for, you know, a dude like myself, you know what I'm saying?
I'm the hopeless romantic.
But I like to write love stories or stories that I feel relate. I think lately in the past 5 years, you know, I used to always try to write like, I can't write it if I didn't go through it type thing. But then I started to learn to like, no, bro, some of the most relatable stories are the stories that we have as conversations, like on the couch, talking to the guys when we're going through things. And it's like, recently I found joy in speaking or being that voice for a vulnerable man.
Wow.
Like, I played football, if we want to get into it, we could be as rough and tough as we want. But I think more in today's society, we need to allow safe spaces for men to be vulnerable, to have emotions, to express themselves, to be able to love, to care, to think and articulate how they feel when they do feel something, and not feel like, you know, I'm less of a man for speaking on it or saying that I feel this way, or that made me feel like not good inside, right? So a lot of the songs I either write are from the perspective of a man that is either coming from a vulnerable place of saying some whack stuff to a woman that's, it might be corny if you walk up to the bar and say it, but when I sing it, you know what I'm saying, it might give that guy at the bar who doesn't have the confidence to walk up and say hello to at least sing these lyrics and now break the ice, right? And then also writing with women to hear a different side. And then also start to understand, like, okay, this is where she's coming from. And if I can at least put myself in her shoes, maybe I might understand a situation like this a lot better when it arises in my own life. Yeah. So I can handle it as such or know how to navigate it without, you know, stepping on anyone's toes or hurting anyone's feelings and making everyone feel seen in her. So I think those are the stories that I like to tell. And those are the songs that I like to write. And then even in writing for, like, you know, film and stuff like that.
Yeah.
I definitely am a sucker for a good love story.
Yeah.
Or what they call them, rom-coms.
Rom-coms.
Rom-coms
are good.
You feel me?
You
know, I was a mama's boy, so I used to be stuck by her hip when she watched Lifetime. So, like, my goal is to do a movie on Lifetime and be like, look, mom, we on Lifetime. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, my mom's in here. Where she at?
What's up, mom?
Yeah, she.
What's up, mama?
My mom in the back.
Yeah.
Shout out to Sonya Prater. My sister in the back, too.
My mom in Indiana, but shout out, mama, I love you.
All the mothers in here. All the mothers. Just clap it up for all the mothers. And just real talk.
All the mothers.
There's a lot of mothers in here, but when we talk about Lifetime, that one, my mother would a Lifetime movie all the time.
Like all day, bro.
You know, we be damn near, I feel like our experiences are Lifetime movies, you know what I'm saying? Randy Moss was a Lifetime movie. That situation was a Lifetime movie. You might pitch that as a, that could be an episode or something.
You gonna film it.
Exactly. That part. I love it.
You feel me?
So yeah, man, that's, so we talked about, you know, we just had the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
And you was just out there in Arizona.
Outside, baby.
You had a chance to play in a Super Bowl.
Yep. With the Broncos.
Yes. So talk about that and then having the experience to go back. You just left out there. You did something with the NFL Players Choir.
Yes.
He's on the NFL Players Choir. The NFL put together a dope group of brothers that are all talented singers, and Nate's a part of that. So shout out to Nate for being part of the NFL Players Choir. But talk to us about your experience playing the Super Bowl and then being out there doing stuff with them for the past Super Bowl.
Man, so my experience in the Super Bowl, y'all like stories? Can I tell a quick story? All right, cool.
That's why we here, brother.
So, you know that Grim Reaper? I was playing in Miami, and that Grim Reaper came down, and he must have caught me on the wrong day because it was a joke, and the coaches was in there, and I kind of, you know, was a little irritated. I was practicing. It was a little hot. It was Miami. So I said a couple things, and I got cut. Long story short, I got cut on Christmas Eve, right? So I'm telling mom, like, yo, I'm about to come home for Christmas. She was like, okay, dope. And then I called her back, like, yeah, I'm really coming home for Christmas, right?
Whoa.
So I went from going home for Christmas to my agent calling me the next day, like, yo, you about to go to the Broncos. We just got you picked up right away. You're going to Merry Christmas, right? So I get on the plane, and I'm going to be real. Leaving Miami, I ain't never been to Denver. I'm like, bro, what's in Denver, bro? It looks so trash. It's snow.
It's cold, like, bro. It was
can't
80.
Breathe. The air thin as hell.
I didn't know that at first. I didn't know that at
yeah,
first.
Yeah, did you, man? I play,
that smacked me there when I got there, cause I'm out there, and you know when you do drills, I'm going hard. Everybody laughing like,
like he wasted all his energy on the first.
You might want to slow down, bro. So, long story short, I get there in December. For everyone out there, playoffs start in January. So here I am, this new guy on the team where they've done all this amazing stuff this whole season. And now I'm literally going to go on what I didn't know at the time would be the best playoff run I've ever been a part of. Where now I'm playing with Peyton Manning, another idol of mine. I'm from Indiana, so I grew up a Colts fan. So I'm playing with Peyton Manning, Wes Welker, Demaryius Thomas, and one guy that I played in.
Rest in peace, Demaryius Thomas.
Rest in peace to him for sure, and Ronnie. So playing with these guys, right, and Champ Bailey. And now probably week two of the playoffs, I'm getting calls like, yo, y'all might got a chance to go to the Super Bowl. I'm like, bro, ain't anybody going to the Super Bowl, bro. I just got cut. I don't care about nothing. I'm new here. They might cut me tomorrow.
Right.
Super Bowl comes up. I'm out there. Wow. Now it's real. Wow. Because an opportunity just a month before that, I'm sitting in a team that ain't making the playoffs.
And now you on a team.
Being a wild boy,
being
ready to cuss out coaches and everything. I get cut. I'm going home for Christmas. Now I'm out here in Denver doing donuts in the snow and getting ready to go to a Super Bowl. Not only was it that Super Bowl, but it was first Super Bowl they had in New York. So to be able to experience everything that comes with the Super Bowl, now I'm walking on the red carpet. What happens? They find out I can sing. So
see how God worked?
They go over and they grab Michelle from Destiny's Child. She's on NFL Network and she's one of the co-hosts. So they come over and they're like, hey, we need you to sing for Xbox. I'm like, what? Give me two of them. And she goes, say my name.
Yes.
And then I hit the harmony. And now it goes viral. And so now something that I love music. I'm at the Super Bowl. I'm literally a kid in the candy store, bro. I shouldn't be here. And now I'm singing with Michelle from Destiny's Child, bro.
Yes.
And I won an Xbox.
Yes. Let's go.
That was before we ever got to the game. We ain't even going to talk about the game because the game was kind of wild. It got out of hand from the first play. It's okay. We got beat. Russell Wilson was doing his thing.
Yep.
He was back when he was doing his thing. Yep. He's going to get back on track now.
Back before the Broncos country. Let's ride.
Let's ride. He wasn't riding. He was falling off, but he going to get back up.
Yes,
there.
He is.
It's okay. But that was my first Super Bowl experience, right?
Yeah.
And to be able to share that moment, but also we lost. And to hear Peyton, an idol of mine, walk in there, thank everybody, you know, with tears in his eyes.
Was this his last? Hurrah?
It was the second to the last.
Okay.
So we went again after.
Okay.
But just watching him prepare after we lost, like literally, you know how everybody come in and handing in their tablets, everybody ready to go home. This is the last game, period.
Yeah.
So everybody get in their cars, they nice, they dress nice, they going to their wives, their families, everybody cool. Peyton sitting in the weight room with the game film on from the Super Bowl, and he's watching everything that he did wrong. And he's marking it down with one of the younger quarterbacks, and he's like, all right, next season, we're going to work on this, this, and this, because they got us here. They did this. They did that. That out route I couldn't really throw, I'm going to work on it. And now the whole offseason, I'm watching him work on every little thing that went wrong in that Super Bowl while still enhancing everything he did well.
Wow.
And then to be on that team, I ended up bouncing out. But the next season, I literally watched him go back, and now he wins.
Damn.
And so it taught me a valuable lesson in learning, like, yo, even though you got there, you didn't quite make it, ain't no time to be sad. Ain't no time to be mad. And while everybody else taking time off, when you feel like you're the greatest, you got to get right back in that lab and face everything you not doing right, be accountable. That next year that we had, every Thursday evening, the Broncos wouldn't even allow any coaches in our meeting. And we called it accountability day. So what happened is Peyton would give you about 5 to 10 seconds to tell off on yourself on film
before he take you out himself.
Ooh-wee. Right? He was one of them?
Bro, I'm talking about, hey, Nate, you're supposed to have an outside release here. Well, what were you thinking here? Nate? Okay, Demarius, since Nate doesn't know how to take an outside release, you're going to be taking an outside release here, buddy. Nate, appreciate you, but you just got demoted, okay? It's okay. Good luck. Outside release, and you're going to catch this. I'm going to throw it to you at about 15 yards. Now I'm looking in the game. He's doing exactly that. And I'm like, dang, bro.
People need to understand that pressure, though. Y'all need to understand, like, Peyton Manning, Drew Brees, I play with. It's so much pressure. Like,
quick.
And I'll give you a story. In New Orleans, my first time I get a chance to run with the first team. So this is like,
that's pressure.
I run into, man, what? Drew Brees say these plays so fast. He's like, blue 16, we got 19 east over. It's like two sentences in one. And I'm like.
And they say it real fast, like just.
And then they like break. I'm like, hold on, wait. Everybody lined up. I'm like, bro, like, I don't even know what I'm doing. So like, I had to like really fake, you know, in this moment that like I knew what I was doing. Game is so fast, bro. Like, especially when you don't know what you're doing. That's why I teach my kids that I train to like, don't just know what you're doing. Know what everybody else is doing. You know what I'm saying? Because you play faster, you play smoother, you ain't thinking as much. So I remember being in that huddle, man, and like one of my homies, Teron Armstead, he was like, because he knew I had the talent, he was like, hey, you ready? I was like, yeah. He's like, all right, here we go. And then the fucking play broke down. I was like, oh, shoot. And we went lined up, and I remember I messed up on this play, right? And it was going to me. I was supposed to run an out. I ran an over. Like, I ran a – the play is rolling to this side, and I'm running away from him, right?
And you're like, the whole outlet, and he has you nowhere.
Nowhere to be found.
He was hot.
Hot. And the thing is about Drew Brees, if you drop a ball by him, every day after practice, we always, like, have another hour session of routes for, like, just our helmets. It'd be another practice. And, like, if you dropped it, you got to go catch that same ball 100 times from him that route so he can build that confidence back in you.
What? I mean, that was, at least he did that. Peyton just standing there and look at you like, get him out of there. He doesn't want to play.
He did sustain like that.
Bro, he.
Read
you with that real quick.
Big old helmet.
Big helmet, bro. He got the biggest head. Love you, Peyton. So here, big as hell, bro.
Pause.
Yeah,
big pause.
Don't get fined.
Like, you're fine. I know.
Now that's a lot of pressure. And then a lot of people don't understand too. When you get moved up like that and you're a young guy, the old guys feel threatened. So when you're running out to the huddle and you're like, hey bro, what route I got?
They be mimes, bro. They be like, he ain't finna take my job. I ain't finna tell you what you
right.
got. You know what I'm
right?
saying?
It's
crazy. It's really crazy out there. Like, as much as we have teammates, as much as these are your brothers that you go to war with, they still got a family to feed.
Oh, I got a story for that.
Go ahead. Talk to them. Go talk to us about that.
Randy Moss, bringing them back in the fold, 49ers. John Harbaugh goes, Nate, stand up. I stand up. So how many kids you got? I said, zero. I was proud. I ain't got no kids. I'm out here. What's up, coach? Like, I'm single out here. What's up? He said, Randy, stand up. How many kids you got? He said, two, maybe three, maybe four, I don't know about, right? Being a joke, right? So he said, Nate, you want to make this team? I said, I'm going to make this team. I'm trying to give him the confidence. Yeah, I'm going to make this team. Inside, I'm like, bro, it's a lot of receivers. I don't know.
Right.
But I'm like, yeah, I'm going to make this team. He said, cool, you got to take all the food out of his kid's mouth. Exactly. Who hit me with the Kevin? Damn. The Kevin Hart, damn.
Damn.
Right? So it hit me different. Because I'm not gonna lie, I'm a humble soul on the inside. I'm a cool guy. Yep. I'm like, the kids, I don't want to take no food from the kids.
Right.
Like, what you mean, coach?
Like, hey, Randy, you want to go?
But it was really perspective. And Randy being real, he was like, hey, bro, he real. Like, you got to go eat. Mm-hmm. Even though you don't have that, and I got this, you got to come take it. And he was like, and I'm gonna be real with you. I ain't going to give it to you, bro. Mm-hmm. These are my kids.
Yeah.
This is my livelihood. So you got to come take that.
Right.
And that's the mental that they start you off with. Even though we on the same team, we playing, you still competing against me every day. They call it the eye and the what?
The eye in the sky?
The eye in the sky don't lie. So they literally watch everything you do every day, every play, every route you run, everything. And it's all for you to have to compete. If we on the same team, I got to take, it's hard, bro, to go play Call of Duty with somebody that's really beating your butt every day in practice, bro. And y'all on the same team. It's a weird dynamic.
That's a very weird dynamic.
It's a weird dynamic. Like, how are we going to be cool? I don't even want you to cook for me, bro. You might poison me. I don't even want to eat. I don't want to drink. You might get me drunk and now go tell the coach. Like, I'm cool.
It's that deep, bro.
It's that deep. So
it's that deep.
That's the story. Yeah, we can go back, bro. Let's get to the questions because I'll talk about football all day.
But that's the thing. We collide in worlds, right? I said we talking with you all, and we want you all to understand our life and our experiences and the plight that we went through. Again, so we're going to talk about Division Street. It's our last song.
Yeah.
As we getting closer to the end of our time here tonight.
I just started sweating already.
Division Street is a song that it's a rendition of Sade a little bit. Yeah, you put your own
King of Sorrow.
Kings of Sorrow, and you swagged it out. And it's a funny story. And I got to tell this story because I called you the other night. And I was like, bro, your first line in this song, I'm crying everyone's tears. I was like, that's hard. And I was like, I talked to my business manager, Dana. She was like, that's Sade's line.
That's Sade's line.
And I was so adamant, I'm like, damn, I got to get back on my history of music, you know? And yeah. King of Sorrow is an amazing song. Y'all know Sade. She's an amazing, amazing artist.
My favorite artist.
She's a beautiful soul, beautiful spirit. And
that's why I like
when it comes to making songs that are renditions or like covers of legends, song like this, you got to be really mindful. Like, don't get up, you know?
Trust.
And I thought you did a great job. We all listened to it. We thought you did a great job, and we're going to play this for y'all right now. This is Division Street by Nate.
I might not sing this one, y'all. This one kind of... She said I did. Yeah, this one was deep.
I'm crying everyone's tears, and they're inside our private wall. Oh, I got bodies, you got bodies. I pray they didn't die the night before. Oh, because I wanna get close to you. Take a deep look into your soul. Get lost in all your imperfections. I pray that you don't change at all. The King of Sorrow. I pray for love tomorrow. King of Sorrow, I pray for love tomorrow. Oh.